Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the June meeting of the Rural Astronomical Society of Canada. Please take a seat, grab a price ticket, and we're going to start right away. Are there any members of the public? Any new astronomers tonight? Great. I'd like you to know that you're welcome. Welcome to this crowd of astronomy geeks. It's okay. When I use the term geek to talk about other geek, it's an honorific. It's not an insult. Someone who's not a geek uses the word geek, and then it's something else. Welcome, geeks. Okay, tonight we have a packed program. I've arranged things very slightly differently tonight. I've noticed that quite a few of us need to leave early, and frequently they wind up missing the observation reports and observation challenges, which I happen to think is one of the most fun parts. So we're going to do that first tonight. And so here are the observation reports. These are reports of, well, basically, we get to tell each other what fun we've been having. So first up is Paul Commission. Before Paul talks about his observing report, I believe he has an announcement about the sun.
Yes, I have. There's a new solar cycle prediction from NASA as of May 29, 2009. An international panel of experts hired by NOAA and NASA has released a new prediction for the next solar cycle. This is solar cycle 24, and it'll peak, they say, in May of 2013 with a below average number of sunspots. If the prediction is correct, solar cycle 24, that is the upcoming cycle, will have a peak sunspot number of 90, the lowest of any cycle since 1928, when the cycle was 76. That was cycle 16. Now, for in 2009, the number of spotless days is 123 as of May 31st, which is 82%. Terrible. So if you've got any equipment, solar equipment, trade it in for a bottle of rum. You won't see anything.
Hey, Paul, would you like to talk about your observations?
Oh, yes. The first one is ARP-28. Now, ARP, these are peculiar galaxies that Halton ARP, who, by the way, was here about 10, 15 years ago. This one, for instance, is NGC 7678. It has an extremely heavy arm, as you can see, and ARP classified as 20. It's a magnitude 12.9, and this is in the constellation Pegasus. Next one, please. This is ARP 65. This is an Andromeda.
Okay.
And as you can see, there are a number of, these are dimmer. These are 15 and 13 and 15 magnitude. And these all have peculiarities to them. You can see the one in the middle has kind of a loose arms on it. It's sort of peculiar. And the next one, please. This is ARP 99, also located in Pegasus. And as you can see, it's like a sort of a quadrangle there. The one on the left on the top, that's NGC 7549, and it's 13.7. The other, that's a star, by the way, on the right of it. And there's two at the bottom. So I thought I'd show you these ARP galaxies are peculiar little groups that have been of interest to deep sky observers for many years. So I thought I'd show these tonight. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Paul.
Yeah.
Next is John Thompson. Would you like to come up and talk about your slides?
Hello. These are three slides that I took just about 2 weeks ago, May 25th, 26th. It was a spectacular night if you were out. M13 was taken prime focus with my 16-inch telescope from my backyard. So the first time doing telescopic astrophotography, we're using a digital SLR. I've done like direct sky photography with that camera before, but this was the first time hooking it up to the telescope. And it's a Starfinder 16 F4.5. Its mount isn't really intended for doing long exposure photography, especially not with film, but the CC, or the CMOS chip in this case, is sensitive enough that I was getting decent images in anywhere from 15 to 20 seconds. I did some 30 seconds, but the drive wasn't quite good enough. It would start to trail after that. So these were just untracked, like unguided, prime focus images. Ring nebula, I don't know if the people that are close may be able to see a red rim around it, hydrogen light. That's also prime focus. And then the third one is M11, was just coming up. So these are all between 15 and 20 seconds. While I was up, I was just asking if anybody had tried for, there was a conjunction of Jupiter and Neptune about 2 weeks ago, that they were less than, I think they were about 0.4 of a degree apart or 0.3 of a degree. But if you tried it, I tried it a couple of times, and it turns out by the time Jupiter is high enough, say 15 degrees above the horizon, the twilight is already coming in. So I made a couple of negative observations on that. But the good news is that because of Jupiter's retrograde motion, there'll be two more chances later this year, one towards the end of July. I think the separation is about 0.4 of a degree, and Jupiter will be up after midnight to see it. And then the third time, after Jupiter resumes its forward motion, there's a third conjunction of Jupiter and Neptune about a week before Christmas is the closest approach. And that'll be in an evening sky, but it'll be fairly easy to observe if anybody wants to give those a try.
This is Paul
Kloninger. Thanks. Hi there. Just got a few to show you there. This is Comet Lulin back in February 28th, I believe. It was a nice opportunity as it passed near Regulus. The color contrast was quite striking. You can learn a lot from the colors there as well. Regulus is blue because of its intensely hot. It's one of the brightest stars in the sky. And Comet Lulin is green because of essentially cyanogen and diatomic carbon in its atmosphere, which two substances which tend to glow green when they're illuminated by the sun in the cold vacuum of space. Next one. Just a couple of shots of the moon there. A nice stable night I had there. I love shooting along the terminator of the moon. These are two of my favorite targets, Archimedes and Plato. They're both rather large craters around the Mare Imbrium basin there, and they both share some commonalities there. They both have flooded floors, so there's not a lot of detail on the floor. I don't know if you can see it, but up in Plato there's a couple of number of small craters. They're about a kilometer and a half to 2 kilometers across. So the floors are relatively featureless. These craters are both roughly the same diameter. Plato's about 109 kilometers across, and Archimedes is about 83. What I really like about them is they both have very jagged rims and jagged peaks along those rims. Some of them are on the order of two or more kilometers in height. So when you get low sun illumination angles there, you get a lot of very cool shadows dancing across this very flat floor. And because of the flat floor, I find that it really brings up that shadow detail. You can see quite a fair bit of detail in the jagged edges of the shadow. So a couple of my favorites. Next one. This last one is a shot of the ISS from about a week and a half ago. This is kind of a tricky beast image. I got this with my 6-inch Maksutov. I had to kind of manually follow it because when I bagged the station here, it was at elevation of about 86 degrees. It was almost virtually at the zenith there and moving pretty quickly. When I showed this to my daughter, she said, well, that's pretty cool, Dad. How far away is this thing? And I thought, okay, well, I'll have to do you an analogy. She just finished her first year at the U of T, and she was living, obviously, on campus there within sight of the CN Tower. So I gave her this analogy here. The space station is about the height of that white transmission tower on the top of the CN Tower. And as it happens, the distance from Toronto to Ottawa is about the same as the orbital height of the ISS. So I said, shooting the ISS that night is like shooting that TV tower in Toronto from Ottawa. Oh, and did I mention that the tower is moving at 8 kilometers a second? she rather enjoyed that. So anyway, that's a interesting ISS passes these days. When you When you've got the passes that come almost directly overhead, it's very, very bright these days. And with the new solar panels that they've attached there, it's at times becoming more like an iridium flare. You're getting a lot of bright flashes from these panels, a lot of reports of these lately. But worth checking out. I've actually followed this with an 80-millimeter telescope, just visually. And you can actually see detail with the naked eye just by, if you can follow it quickly enough. It moves pretty quick. But just thought I'd share that with you. Thank you.
Thank you, Paul. Bob Olson.
This is a continuation of my adventures with the Suravolo telescope. I'm still blowing out the stars and having some trouble guiding it, but other than that, it's working great. This is the challenge object, the Whale Galaxy, which is NGC 4631, and it really looks like a whale to me. When you see it in the scope, it really does too. If you're trying to find this, it's sort of like under the handle of the Dipper, about 20 degrees below that, and it's about 30 million light years away. It's a crowded part of the sky, and it's part of a group of galaxies. And depending on who you read from, it's either 5 to about 30 galaxies. Now, that seems to be a kind of a big range. And this particular galaxy has so many supernovas in it that it's blowing out white-hot gas, X-ray. It actually emits in X-rays. And this stuff is forming this big halo all around the galaxy. That I'm seeing here now in visual, but it shows up actually in X-ray stuff. Okay, next one, please. This is the hockey stick and the other challenge object, and the deformation down here is caused by being close to the whale. It's pretty close to that, and I just basically plugged this into my computer, and my telescope pointed at this and centered up somewhere around here, I guess. But when I developed it, there seems to be a whole lot more down here. So, I don't know if this is the center of the galaxy or not. Sometimes when I was reading about it, they suggested that it could actually be two galaxies there combining. Okay, next one. And this is what they look like in the sky. And you can see how close they are. My field of view is about a third of a degree across and about a quarter of a degree high. I know I've done a little cropping. I guess this is a better example down here. A quarter of a degree, a third of a degree. And you could see that most eyepieces would have these in the same field. Okay, next one. This is my rendition of M57. It's something I really enjoy looking at through a telescope, and was one of my very first telescopic views in it. And I believe it was Gary Boyle who showed it to me at Charleston Lake. It's about 2,300 light years away, and the star in the middle is a medium mass star, sort of like the sun, and it exhausted all of its hydrogen fuel. And when that happens, it turns into a red giant and starts blowing off some of its atmosphere. It blows off about a third of the gas that's in the star. And these super hot winds can blow stuff away either continually or in pulses. I believe this one must be in pulses. And you end up with this really attractive image in stars, now in image in this scope. Now the green is oxygen, excited oxygen, and the red is either nitrogen or hydrogen, I guess, depending on the two colors combine. And there's just a few atoms per cubic centimeter. These are really thin material. And it's a kind of a flattened sphere, which is tilted about 30 degrees. So it's not a circle. It has a little bit of shape to it. The star in the middle now has about 60% of the mass of the sun, but it's 200 times as luminous as the sun. And it's turning into a white dwarf. The galaxy at the bottom is one of Attila's. He likes to check that one out with his scope, see how good the seeing is. Transparency check. And that's IC 1296. Shows up very nicely in this photo. Okay, the next one, please. Oh. Now, I'd like to say that I planned this, but it was getting late at night, and I needed something that was coming up in the east so that I could put my scope on it and go to bed, and so it would track across the sky all night. And so I looked in Starry Night, and this is what I found, was this Iris Nebula. It's NGC 7023. It's about 1,300 light years away. It's in the constellation Cepheus in the northeast at 11 o'clock at night. The blue is starlight from this hot young star, and that's about 10 solar masses there in the middle. And we know that because the spectrum of that blue is the same as the spectrum of the star. So we know it's reflected light. If you looked closely at it, and I was a better photographer, you'd see a little bit of pink. And the pink is just in around in this area in here. It's not showing up as far as I can tell from here. But it's that's from actually photoluminous of the dust being excited by the ultraviolet from the very, very bright star. And the dark is cold dust and molecular gas, the black. And the IR absorption spectrums of this thing suggest that there are complex carbon molecules in here. And the nebula itself is about 6 light years across.
Okay, so this is Saturn. So Saturn is starting to kind of disappear, so I thought I'd better get an image. Now, you notice that the rings are, instead of being kind of white, they're kind of dusky because they're actually being illuminated from the other side, so or practically edge on. So most of the ring particles are actually in shadow from the sun. The sun is it's a slightly higher angle than we're looking at Saturn. And the rings are quite colorful. Next. Okay, this is M3 with a 6-inch and a DSLR. And the thing to notice also is that the stars in the middle are very blue and the stars on the outside are more yellowish. So the older stars are on the outside, I think is what they postulate. And a 15-minute exposure. Well, actually, 3 times 5 minutes. Next. Okay, so this is M57 night, I guess. Everybody's showing M57. We heard the story of it. There's a NGC 1296. And there's this other galaxy here, I think. The other challenge object, was it, Attila?
There is a galaxy there. I don't think it's been listed as a challenge object. The other challenge object was the outer halo. Which, if you look very carefully at Bob's slide, he did just barely capture it. I'm not sure the projector is capable of showing it.
Yeah, that's pretty hard to get. So so this is stars are quite colorful, but the next slide, I zoomed in a bit and tried to get a better color and better rendition of the core. This is actually at about the full scale of the DSLR. The other ones were slightly reduced. So that gives you kind of an idea of what the image scale would be of kind of 1-to-1 on the DSLR and the in that kind of a scope. So, but the thing to remember is that the whole frame was like this big, and this is all quite cropped. Next, this was 95 minutes. On M64, the Black Eye Galaxy. It's a very good position right now. It's almost, I wouldn't say straight up, but it's quite high at this time. And a lot of interesting detail in the middle. Next slide. So the problem here with M104 is I was only able to get two 10-minute frames done. It's getting very low, so unfortunately, these trailed, but again, the very, very famous Sombrero Galaxy with this dust in the middle, and it should have been quite a bit bigger. But since I only got the two very poor exposures, that's it. Again, with DSLR on a 6-inch. Okay, next.
Thank you very much, Rolf.
Oh, okay. So next is the other thing,
yeah,
right?
Great images. Okay. I particularly like this segment where people show us great images. Speaking of great images, we just got this call from the central office of the RSC. Next slide, please, Richard. Dave Lane would like us to send him great images. Well, what a coincidence. We have lots. So all of you who have been presenting observations over the last 10 years or who have been too scared to get up on stage and actually talk to your picture, have actually enough for contributing it to the calendar. The deadline is very soon, but apparently I've heard he's received very few candidates so far, so the field is wide open. So along the lines of doing observing, now we're going to talk about what observations that we can do in the future. And first we have a planetary challenge. This is new. Previously we've had lunar challenges and deep sky challenges. In the future, I'm kind of hoping people might offer, say, naked eye challenges or, say, solar observing challenges. But I think for each meeting, we should have two of the selection. And right now we have Rolf Meir with a planetary observing challenge.
Okay, so I guess the challenge this month will be the moons of Saturn and Jupiter. So Saturn kind of fading away in the evening sky, and you have to get it pretty early before it fades away. Jupiter just coming up very early in the morning, but you'll have all summer to observe Jupiter. So start getting ready now for Jupiter and finish off on Saturn. So the thing is, with Saturn right now, the rings are almost edge on, and that means that the moons are almost always very close to the planet. So this is a few weeks ago when I was able to get five of the moons as they're moving around the planet. You can see this one here kind of disappears, Dione. I'm not sure why. It was supposed to pass in front, and I guess it just got lost in the contrast there. There's several other moons very close in. Mimas was actually in here, but it was 13th magnitude. Enceladus here is at 12th magnitude. So these are all fairly easy to see. But the thing is that there are a few occurrences. This is Titan, and Titan's shadow, and the shadow of Dione and Rhea and Tethys will often appear on Saturn. And that only happens when the rings are edge on. So that's the challenge with Saturn. And the next slide. So this is Jupiter last week, was it? So what I was hoping to get, now the problem is, I mean, it's still very fairly low. It was about 20 degrees up at the time. So the seeing is still not very good, and it varies quite a bit. So I was hoping to get like a whole hour here. I was only able to get 15 minutes. But this is actually two moons, Ganymede and Io, and Ganymede passing in front of Io. So what's happening here is mutual events of two of Jupiter's satellites, one passing in front of another. And that's fairly rare to see.
You're saying that Jupiter is spinning, and that's a 15-minute period?
Yes. So this is between, I took images about 3 minutes apart.
We're fast enough.
Yeah, so don't expose for too long, because that's why I only did the green filter. Because to do the RGBs, you need to be a lot faster than that. You can see how quickly it moves. This is like a 15-minute span. So what I was hoping was that these would be resolved a little bit better, and you could see them crossing in front of each other and separating. So people have posted better views of that, and this is the red spot, I guess. So this is all very nice, but how the heck do you find out about this, right? That's your question. So next slide. So this is how I found out. So there's a website called CalSky, and this was about 5 minutes later. So 5 minutes later, Callisto was appearing from just behind Jupiter, and I was hoping to capture that too. And here, I don't know if you can see, it's not quite round, but here, this is what it looked like. Ganymede in front of Io. So that's what I was hoping to capture. So I check here periodically, right? So you can remember that website? Well, you probably don't, but there's an easy way to find it, and that's if you go to the clear sky chart. Everybody knows how to get to the clear sky clock? So there's a link here for CalSky in the deep sky every deep sky clock. So that's it. So that's how you would find out about the satellites of Jupiter and Saturn and find out the predictions. So if there's anything going on tonight, you can just look at that. Now, the only thing I would caution about is there's probably a bug in it, because Callisto was appearing. And sometimes the moons will be shown in front of the planet when they're actually behind it. And they don't always show when the moons go into a shadow behind the planet. So you do have to watch that. So there's a few other resources on the web to see about that. So one thing that you can tell is which direction they're moving. So if the moons are moving in the same direction as the planet is turning, that means they're in front. And if they're moving in the opposite way that the planet is turning, then they're behind. So just check, maybe you can set the time on CalSky. You can just tell it what time you want to do your simulation, and it will it'll show it at exactly that time, and you can step through times and see what happens. Of course, there's other planetary programs out there that could.
The colors are so brilliant there. Has that picture been colorized to the deep red, and that, do you know, or is that natural?
This is a simulation. Yeah, this is what you would see through a very good telescope on a very good night. But these are basically simulations. Mars is a lot more accurate, because the features on Mars don't change. But Jupiter and Saturn, because of the clouds and they're changing, like if you looked at it from one day to the next, it'll be a completely different appearance. So the only thing that's really constant is the red spot. Everything else is just a guess.
Thank you very much, Will.
Okay.
Good stuff.
No, you did. Yeah, you were right.
I just pressed the...
Or you can say click.
Okay, I'll do that. Okay, so when you think about Cygnus, you may have visions of the North American nebula, maybe the wisps of a supernova remnant, a colorful double star, or certainly the richness of the Milky Way. But what about observing galaxies? That would seem like an unlikely area to look for them. It would be kind of like going to hot, sunny Arizona for skiing, something that seems unlikely. But actually, it can be done in both cases. Next slide. Okay, so for the Deep Sky Challenge this month, there's two objects I'd like to suggest. They are both in Cygnus, two galaxies. Do we have a laser?
Center button on that thing.
Okay, got it. Okay, so the first one here, UGC-11492. It's there's actually all these red things you see are the galaxies, and it was just brought to my attention that there's also another large face-on galaxy just off the map at the top there. That's apparently quite nice. But the two I'm going to work on is this one here, which is actually apparently a nice barred nearly face-on galaxy. Go to the next slide. And actually, just back up a sec, and I'll just so you recognize, this is Deneb right here. So we're actually right into the western side of Cygnus, which that area happens to be conveniently positioned in mid-June, about halfway up, or a little more than halfway up in the east, about 60 degrees high. So it's actually a good time to see it before it gets too close to the zenith, when some telescopes have a hard time navigating in that area. Okay, next slide, please. So there's our barred spiral galaxy. Now, don't be fooled by the small fuzzy patch you see from this sketch. Using high magnification and a moderate to large telescope, this object has a lot of potential. It should show mottling, and it should show some structure because of the barred spiral structure. And for those of you who have long focal length telescopes and CCD setups, this could prove to be potentially a very interesting target to try out. This sketch is based on a 16-inch daub. Okay, next slide. Now we're back to our map and our second object, which is UGC-11466, also known as, or maybe not so well known as, the Arrowhead Galaxy. And you'll understand why in just a moment. This is one of my personal favorites among the small, faint galaxies, because it's a really a weird object. I've rarely seen one with that kind of shape. And to find it, it's actually quite simple. If you have a Telluride and a low-power eyepiece, you shouldn't have too much trouble getting it. It's right down here, almost directly between the third mag and the fifth mag stars. So you just can just sort of scan the area between those two stars, and the low power eyepiece will pick up that little fuzz. But it's a significantly smaller object than the previous galaxy, so it will take magnification quite well, since it has a fairly high surface brightness. Now, next slide. There's our sketch of it. It's a really weird thing, definitely a peculiar type galaxy. It's magnitude 12, but again, it's got a fairly high surface brightness. And the reason for the really weird shape is because we're looking through all this dust across the plane of our galaxy, some portions of this object are actually blocked from view, so we're seeing it only maybe half of the actual galaxy. But I'd be really curious to see what you guys think about it. And again, those of you with imaging setup, what can you actually pick up? Can you actually see more of the object than can be seen visually or by sketching? So as you see, also the tip of the arrow is conspicuously brighter than the broad head. I've seen this thing in an 8-inch scope, but very faintly under a good sky. A larger aperture is definitely required to make out details or make out any kind of structure. So again, I recommend maybe giving it a try, see what you think, and hopefully get some good reports next time. Now, the thing to remember with those two objects is that they are both less than 15 degrees from the dusty plane of the Milky Way. So this is an area that to see any detail in those objects outside of the Milky Way, it would be quite an accomplishment. Any questions?
You got the coordinates for them?
The coordinates, I could provide that maybe in the report.
You should look that up for yourself.
Yeah. Good idea.
Thank you very much, Pierre.
Okay, thank you very much.
Excellent. So we've been doing these, I think, Brian McCulloch introduced the Observing Challenges segment of this meeting about 2 years ago, and I think they're tons of fun. The guys in Toronto, also known as the National Center of the RAC, has just discovered the concept, and they've put out this wonderful new great idea. They're calling for Observing Challenges to be included in the handbook. Well, this should be really easy for us. So I suggest that any of you who have submitted an Observing Challenge over the last 10 years, or if you'd like to think of a new one, feel free to email Alistair Link. For that matter, if you come up with a really good one, why don't you propose it for next month or the month afterwards? Stephen McIntyre is going to tell us what we can observe in the general sky over the next month. You might have to take over, Richard.
He's on drugs.
Right, so I'm going to talk more about small scopes and binoculars and unaided observation rather than 16-inch Dobsonians. There we go. All right, we get it over with rather quickly, though, but because of long days and really short nights, there really isn't any astronomy for ordinary people, but you know, that might not be a problem for this crowd. I plotted the sunrise, sunsets, and various twilights for the Ottawa area, and then added daylight savings time to it, and so you get astronomical sunset or twilight starting around 11:30 in the Ottawa area and ending around 2:30. So there's really only 3 hours of completely dark skies. By the second week in June, the moon is even rising late, so you can't see that. And Saturn is, it's kind of low in the sky, 22 degrees. That's still better than Jupiter was all last year, but it's kind of setting as well. Although that's astronomical sunset for Ottawa and around the outskirts, probably the nautical sunset or twilight is a much better indication of a reasonable sky to go out, particularly for anything but a deep sky challenge. So the sky will look like that. I chose sort of 11 o'clock mid-month as a reference point. It probably won't look quite that dark from around the Ottawa area. The Milky Way is starting to rise in the east. Over in the west, we've got Saturn just under Leo. And as I said, it's about 22 degrees, so it's still a good object to see. The rings are pretty well edge-on, which is kind of a cool thing to see. Saturn signing just a tad under first magnitude. Below that, we have first magnitude Spica in marking the one of the she's the wheat in the constellation Virgo, home to hundreds and maybe thousands of objects I can't see in my 3-inch telescope. About dead south, we have Arcturus. It's the third brightest star in the sky, and it's the brightest object in the sky in June in Ottawa. Next to that, we have the constellation Hercules. It's really just magnitude 2 and 3 stars, but the 4 stars in the middle make it a very easy object to find. And then, we've got the Cygnus marked by Deneb, which is, I think, magnitude 1 1/4, which is where the deep sky challenges are. And then between those, we have Vega. It's the fifth brightest star in the sky, and it will be the second brightest object in the June sky, shining at magnitude 0. It's also a pure white star, so it actually shines quite bright, even though it's slightly dimmer than Arcturus. And it's probably a good test of your apochromatic optics, so any color you're seeing is going to be part of your optics and not part of the star. Below that, we've got Altair. The eagle, and below that it's either Ganymede, which Zeus sent to Aquila with the star Altair, and so Zeus sent Aquila to fetch Ganymede, or it's Antinous, that's an asterism that was created in the early around the year 200, where a boy drowned in the river, and Hadriat defined an asterism in that area. The best objects, I think, there's three just spectacular globular clusters that are due south and in a nice little triangle. All are easily catched in binoculars, and if on a good night, you might be able to see some of them unaided. So we've got M3 in the constellation Bootes, shining at magnitude 6.3, or the visual magnitude. Officially, it's 18 arc minutes across, but visually in a small scope, it'll probably appear more like 10. This one's a bit of a challenge to see unaided. Particularly in anywhere but a completely dark sky, but easily found in binoculars. All three objects, I went out on Tuesday just from my house south of Carp, and with the moon at 80% illuminated, I could find all three with the binoculars just around 10:15, which was astronomical twilight, so easy to find. In 4-inch scope, you start seeing some grainy edges. In a large scope, you're going to see stars throughout. If you happen to have a scope kind of in the 2-meter range, it's going to look something like that. Not to diminish Rolf's excellent picture of M3, and then you start seeing the blue and yellow colors there as well. M5 in the constellation Serpens Capit. It's a little bit harder to find. There's no really strong reference points in the area, although the bright star in Serpens Capit, it's magnitude 2.6, and it's really the only star of that magnitude in the area. And M5 is about 7 degrees southwest of that, so just about a field's width of a 7x50 binocular, so fairly easy to see. Slightly larger at 23 arc minutes, but it's still visually the compact core is in that 10 to 12 minute range. The observing notes I read says, you can probably see this one under extremely good conditions, but easily caught in binoculars, and even in a 4-inch scope, some of the stars in the outer reaches start to resolve. And then the notes I've read saying that in a larger scope, you start to see some structures, some spidery legs and gaps within the core. And then that's the picture of M5. Interestingly, I find that it was difficult to find images of this particular globular cluster, although it's one of the brighter ones. I thought it would be easy to find an image. M13 in Hercules, generally regarded as the brightest globular cluster in the northern sky, although visual magnitude is only 5.8. but my reading of this is that it's a slightly more compact core, so surface brightness will be a little bit more. So I assume when it's noted as the brightest globular cluster, it's really referring to surface brightness. This one you can see in a reasonably dark sky. It's also easy to find with the reference in the four stars in Hercules. And in larger scopes, even around 11-inch scope, you'll start to see the blue and green colors visually, so it's quite a spectacular object to see. And there's the another 2-meter, 3-hour data acquisition picture. A favorite topic and a standard one is the double-double in Lyra. Just a little bit above, or actually probably to the east of Vega. You can catch the two stars, Lyra 1 and Lyra 2, in binoculars. And in a small scope, 3 inches, you can easily catch Lyra 2A and 2B at 2.3 arc seconds, so fairly easy to catch. But Lyra 1A and B, depending on where I read, so I decided to go with Starry Night data, it's at 1.5 arc seconds, which is just slightly below the resolving power of a 3-inch scope, which is at 1.55, or the theoretical limit. But what makes this particularly interesting is that the dramatic difference in orientation gives you that reference point. So what I'm looking at is a double star. It's not a trick of my eye or an aberration of my optics or some stretch of the sky. So you can, knowing that one is, and also with the 2.3, you can really separate that one. And then even if you're seeing a fuzzy oval, knowing the orientation, you're kind of in the right ballpark to know that you've actually resolved those stars. Interesting grazing tomorrow evening, actually, and the weather's not looking too bad. So we've got Antares grazing, or the moon grazing Antares' northwestern limb. You've got, it's about 11:07 or 11:08 Eastern Standard Time, and the path is shown there. You probably, if you want to be sure, you're going to catch it to be slightly west of the center line, but within about 2 kilometers. So my simulation in CARP completely missed the grazing, and that's only that's about 20 kilometers west or east of this. And if you're too far west, it's going to be an occultation, so you kind of want to err on the side of the west. And so it's an interesting object just to see, particularly binoculars or small scope, and webcam, you can catch it. So the professionals are using this kind of an event to better characterize the landscape of the limb. Capturing it in a webcam is going to be challenging because the moon is almost full, and so contrast and brightness will be a bit of a problem. And that's the highlights. Just two I'll just pick out here. Tomorrow, Venus is at 50% illumination in the morning sky, meaning you'll probably be able to see it well after twilight, so it's kind of interesting thing to see. And then on the 19th, there's a very interesting grouping, about 8-degree field wide of Mars, Venus, and the moon in the morning sky again.
Thank you very much, Stephen. Excellent.
Yeah, if any of you have ever tried to mount a heavy binocular on top of a standard camera tripod, you'll quickly discover that as you try to look at higher angles in the sky, the weight of the instrument becomes very offset from the altitude pivot axis. It's hence very cantilevered, and unless you've got the strength of Arnold Schwarzenegger to tighten things down so the binocular doesn't slip and continue to fall, it becomes very cumbersome to use, and even making small adjustments is problematic as well. So what you want to do is to devise a mount so that the center of mass of the binocular coincides with the center of rotation of the axis. That way you don't have to tighten things very much to keep the instrument steady, or if it's really well balanced, you don't even have to tighten it at all. Now, I was commissioned, shall we say, by a gentleman named Paul to build for him a mount to carry an 88mm right-angle binocular that he's had now for a few years. And until now, mounting it on a standard tripod was a bit of a problem, like I've just described. We could bring up the first slide right now. And it's really very simple. I first tried to make a somewhat fancy little yoke to carry the binocular, but I wasn't satisfied. And I stumbled around for a while trying to come up with a good alternate. And eventually, I had an idea that required almost zero machining. You can see here a standard Manfrotto camera tripod. Now, because the binocular is a right-angled type, you don't have to have a tall tripod because you're looking down when the instrument is pointed up. So the whole thing can be kept very compact. Because the tripod has a center post with a hand crank, so you can adjust the height of things vertically over a sufficient range, the extendable tripod leg segments were not required. So I just took those out. That was 6 pieces of metal. 3 of them were actual steel tubing. So I shaved a good 5 pounds off the weight of the tripod just by doing that. On top of the rather stout camera head seated on top of the tripod is mounted a lightweight aluminum bar, kind of like a double I-beam. It's very light but very stiff. And even with weight offset along the side, it does not torque at all. It has strong torsional strength. So the bar, it's just about 2 feet long, and I put the mounting point where it sits on the tripod right about dead center. On the right side, you can see a dangling hook. That was just a quick expedient for hanging a counterweight. And then on the near side of the bar is just another somewhat lighter weight Manfrotto video pan head, which is designed for video work so that it has smooth motion as you want to tilt and pan. So it has a kind of a semi-fluid motion to it. The only thing that I really had to search around for and eventually get made was the angled bracket. It looks kind of like a letter Z, if you will. That's just a piece of steel iron stock that I went down to Cohen & Cohen and selected a length of it, had them cut it, and one of the guys there just heated it up with an acetylene torch and pounded it into shape. And the main point of it is that the instrument, when mounted, the center of mass lines up with the vertical axis of rotation. So this here, this little tightening knob, the vertical axis of rotation runs this way. So when the binocular is seated on here and mounted with this bolt from underneath, it's fairly well balanced, and then you don't have to worry about it getting out of control. A simple 3/8 inch bolt with a slightly enlarged hole with a drill holds that very securely. There's no need to worry about it twisting because the steel is very strong, and there's enough of a gap here that it's got some good spring force. So when I reefed down on the nut and tightened it, it's on there really good. It's almost as good as having it welded in place. In the next slide, we'll see a close-up view now of the business end where that pan head and the angle bracket are located. And you can just visualize very easily that as the thing swings in altitude, the bottom part of this kind of swings out and upward as you're looking higher and higher in the sky. In the next slide, we see the 88 millimeter right angle binocular mounted and looking at a moderate upward angle and looking straight up toward the zenith. The rotation also of this little mount is a very handy additional feature because that means if you're trying to sweep around over a certain range of sky from one seated position, this becomes a kind of an azimuth pivot point, so the binocular can swing around in an extra degree of movement, and the aluminum bar on which it's seated, it's able to swing around as well. So you've got a number of degrees of freedom, meaning that you can cover a significant part of the sky without having to get up and relocate your chair. And the right angle binocular observing as well means that this is a little bit easier than with a straight-through binocular on a standard parallelogram mount. I believe that this arrangement would allow you to see more sky without having to keep relocating your chair or the binocular tripod or both. And in the next slide, we can see Paul demonstrating it in use. And this was just after delivering it to him. And the quick and easy solution for a counterweight was just this plant watering jug partly filled with water. And the weight of this counterweight, I've discovered, doesn't have to be as heavy as the binocular and such. This incidentally is about 14 pounds. This binocular is very dense. the weight here, it only needs to be about half to two-thirds the weight, and it will still do the job effectively. The main thing is just to keep the now heavy instrument from wanting to topple over to the side because of hanging out well away from the center of support of the tripod. And I believe I have one more image. Yes, Paul just located in another part of his deck. And Paul has reported to me that in most respects, it meets all expectations. He is pretty happy with it, which I'm glad to hear. And I wish that I'd had the idea earlier about just that simple little addition of an iron bracket on the camera tripod. I would have actually had it delivered to him a lot sooner than the rather delayed delivery date that I settled on. If I have a moment, if anybody has a question or two, I'd be happy to answer.
Could we take questions at the...
By all means. Yes, that's fine. No trouble at all.
Thank you very much, Glenn.
You're welcome.
I'm a new member of the RASC. Glad to have joined. My observatory is called the South Nation Space Station. I live in the South Nation Conservation Area, about 30 miles east of Ottawa. Beautiful area. I didn't want a regular name. Everybody calls their observatory something, something observatory. I wanted to be different, so I called it South Nation Space Station. I like alliteration. Here are some of the first images that I've tried from my site. A lot better than I ever obtained with film. So here's the observatory. It's made out of sheets of 4x8 plywood, and it's covered with aluminum sheeting. Very functional. So this is how I built it. I basically cut four rings of 4x8 ply, 4-inch radius, 3-foot, 6-inch radius, and the top ring, and the top ring is 3 foot by 10. Now every 15 degrees, I have a cross rib, and the dome width is 3 feet, so a foot and a half from the center is where I made my cross rib. The important thing here is that every rib, that you cut a tangent to that rib so that you have something to nail the sheet metal to. So here's the dome with the cross struts in place. Now, this is a 3-foot 10-inch radius, whereas this is a 3-foot 6-inch radius all the way to the back, and I wanted the back of the dome to be flat. This is a 3-foot 8-inch radius because I wanted a lip around the dome to keep it basically weatherproof. So here's one side of the dome, almost completed. So you see I still have a couple of struts to put in. Now the thing about the dome is, this is a 3-foot 10-inch radius. Every rib was 4 inches thick, or 4 inches wide, I should say. Now all of these ribs, they're all the same shape. The only thing to remember is that as they come down the side, they keep getting shorter. So basically what I did is I built a template and I calculated how much shorter they get as they go down. Now, this is 30 degrees, 45, 60, 75, 90. The angle at the top that you have to cut here is the opposite of what it is at the bottom. So 30 degrees, the cut has to be 60 degrees here. Now, I didn't have the tools to do this, so I had to do it all by handsaw. A lot of work, but it's a work of love, and it works very well. All of the joints, all the angle iron, I just bent it by hand to fit the approximation of how it should meet the cross strut. Now here's the back of the dome. This is the important part. This cross rib here follows this angle, so it's flat to the back of the dome. Now here, the other one, the 3-foot 6-inch radius, has to be cut to an angle of 30 degrees. Now, I didn't have the most fancy tools. I couldn't cut this angle with a gauge or anything. So, I had to sand that cut to about a 30-degree angle all the way from the front to the back, 10 sand belts later. So, here's the dome. Now, you'll notice here at the back that I have a shelf that I left in place, and it's very important to do that. The 3-foot 6-inch radius, the 4 inches wide, so it's 3-foot 6, 3-foot 2. This shelf is 3-foot 2 on the inside to 3-foot 6 at the back, so there's room for another strut at the back of the dome to keep it solid. Now, I think I've missed a slide here. This is the second dome I built. The first dome I built, I tried to make it turn on four wheels pointing up and four wheels pointing out, and I made a lot of mistakes. I covered the thing with plywood. It was a beast. It wouldn't turn worth anything. So basically what I did this time is I built a golf ball race out of plywood. So the dome basically turns on golf balls. Cheap solution. I didn't want to be bothered bending angle iron. It turns very well. The thing is, I filled the race with golf balls, and as I spun the dome, all these golf balls kept spitting out all over the place. So I dutifully picked them all up, put them all back in, and as I spun the dome again, they'd all spit out again. So basically what I did is I just kept rotating the dome until it stopped spitting out golf balls, and now it works great. So here's how I covered it. I bought a roll of about 120 feet, 2 feet wide sheet metal, and rolls of shelving paper, semi-sticky, and I basically, I'll leave it there. So basically what I did is I traced the outline of the outer edge of the ribs, and then I just transferred the shelving paper to my sheet metal, and I traced around it with a pencil, and then I pulled it off and I cut it by hand. Most important thing here, wear gloves, because if you don't, you're gonna get a lot of metal slivers in your hands, believe me. So here's one side of the dome. So basically what I've done is, you see, I've basically airline jointed it all the way up to the top, siliconed on the inside of the joint, and everywhere that it overlaps, it's siliconed again. So it's starting to look like a dome. Now here's the inside. The sheet metal that I bought is white on the inside, and I wanted the inside of my dome to be white, so I'm in the process of painting it here. Sorry, figure this out. So here's the dome, again, starting to look decent. Now here's the cross strut at the back that I mentioned that you need that shelf at the back to support. And here's the back of the dome. You see it's flat. Maybe in the future I'll try to get some type of mechanism that allows me to roll the door back, but at the moment I haven't. Now the thing is, I tried to hide the joints here. So I cut a 2-inch strip and I nailed it. I shouldn't have nailed it like that. It looks as bad as the other joints do. So what I did from then on is I just cut the strip and I nailed it once at the bottom, siliconed it, nailed it once at the top. And if there was any overlap or loose edges there, I just chiseled them out of the way. So there's a close-up. Here's the door. I just went through my remnants of wood to find something that matched the slit as best I could, and then I just basically built a frame and covered it with the sheet metal. Now it's split at the top here, so the dome top flips up so that I can see the zenith. Am I going the right way here? So here's the dome in the backyard. The bottom, I built it square, again, 4x8 standard construction. And it sits on a wooden floor. I eventually would like to put in a concrete platform, but at this point, I want to make something bigger. So I'm going to, it's like aperture fever. So here's the inside of the dome. Every astronomer should have a dome. It's great. I can't stress it enough. So in the spring, I install my mead because I want the aperture to look for galaxies. In the summer, and I don't know why, but that's not the right picture. I have a Williams Optics 132 that I install for wide field views of the galaxies, or of the Milky Way, I'm sorry. So here's my view looking south-southwest. When I moved out to Wendover, I wanted a low horizon and I wanted dark skies. Now inside the dome, basically what I did is, it's 2x4 construction, but at the center it's 2x6, and I've notched it out so that it fits over the 2x4s. In the corners, I went through some of my remnant wood as well and just stuck it in the corner, and on top of that, I put a 2x6 inch all the way up to the top, the base ring, so that it supports the ring all the way around. Again. So thank you. I do have plans available if anybody wants them. Thank you.
I agree.
Okay, can you go to the next slide? Can you go to the next slide? Okay, well, everyone, tomorrow's the big day. After a lot of planning, and you may remember me talking about this way back, and I think in October at least, I talked about the process that I went through to apply for the Galileo Lecture as one of the Canada IYA events. And I was able to secure a lecture. It's a CASCA-sponsored event, and our lecturer, Dr. Abraham, is coming tomorrow. You've probably seen my emails that I send out. It's an event at Carleton University, the Bell Theater and the Minto Center in Carleton University. I just updated the map to make it real clear on our website where the event is. But I can tell you, I've seen Dr. Abrams' presentation. He's got it's an unconventional presentation. It's not a dry lecture. He's got lots of sort of videos and my email exchange with him. He looks like he's pumped. So this is going to be quite an event, and we're all looking forward to it. I've been sending out emails to a bunch of people who have expressed interest in outreach events, and they've sent me emails back saying they're looking forward to this. So I'm excited about that as well. In addition to the lecture, we're also offering solar observing, daytime planet observing, and our usual suite of displays and so forth. Ronce Martin, meteorite fellow, Chuck O'Dale, meteor creator. We're going to have a full suite of offering. So we're really looking forward to this. It's a big event, and if I could ask one thing from each one of you, sort of the takeaway from this is please do what you can to share this with your friends and neighbors. So even if you're not going to attend tomorrow, try and ask your neighbor if they're interested. Maybe forward an email. I'm going to send out another reminder email tonight. Just try and see if you can promote this event and encourage someone else to attend. But otherwise, it'd be great if you all could attend tomorrow, because it's going to be a big deal. All right, that's it. Thanks.
Hi, if this presentation were a hamburger, you'd have a right to ask, where's the beef? Because what I'm going to show you is the before and after photos taken of an IYA 2009 show I put on for the Gloucester Senior Adult Center. I had the audacity to call it Solar System Odyssey, and I used music that you would recognize. The timeline for it is 1 minute and 10 seconds, and it's from a well-known Odyssey movie going back to 1968. So the presentation, the material that I put on was an hour and a half, all computerized, a blend of downloaded material, original stuff I created, excellent DVD material, which was hard to come by and a bit expensive, from the teaching company, their great courses, and Alex Filipenko, the main lecturer that I used, his set of Understanding the Universe, an Introduction to Astronomy, second edition, is for someone who really wants abuse with DVDs. It's 96 half-hour lectures, 48 hours of superb stuff. And I was able to use some of that. I'm glad to say I didn't have to create all of this from scratch. If I were to put we had 27 Galileo moments. If I were to rate it in terms of hours per moment, I would never have gone there. It was a huge effort to put together. So these are, as I said, the top and bottom of the hamburger bun that preceded the presentation, preceded and followed. And Attila tells me that in August he has a 15 or 20 minute slot I'm going to hold him to, where you can see excerpts from some of this stuff. It was elementary stuff by our standards, of course. It was layman stuff. But the imagery and the quality of some of the material take your breath away. So may we have the first slide, please? Well, the first slide is there. How did I know that? I didn't know. This is the astronomy event type poster that you can get from Canada Node. And the little text in the middle is removable, so I can use this same poster in the future. And the text is, next slide, please. if you take a moment to absorb that, it'll save me a bit of voice. Now, in particular, if you haven't seen the Valles Marineris movie that is part of Mars and Martians, one of Filipenko's lectures, quote, it's a terrific thing in itself, based on endless numbers of radar measurements and photos from various Odyssey and other orbiters. And so it's a simulation of going through this, quite dramatic. If we go on now, we'll see some of my wares. There I am pointing out to somebody. I brought a good collection of books, other exhibits. You may spot some National Geographic special issues. The one on space, the past, and the once and future frontier is terrific. I've got The End of Night and Saturn, as you've never seen it before. And some of my favorite books on the planets, I think there's nothing to beat Solar System Odyssey by Serge Brunet. And he's the co-author also of the new Atlas of the Moon, which I had there. And there are Astronauts and da-da-da-da-da. So a few people showed interest in this. Let's go on and we'll see somebody showing interest. He's looking at the new Atlas of the Moon. Was quite taken with it. I didn't take it away with him. The next slide is another preamble, and this is a young 18-year-old grandson of the lady in the foreground, and he's got a nice 18-year-old smile, and he enjoyed this very much, which I thought was good. The next time, this is not color enhanced, but contrast arranged, because it was far too dark. I'm just doing a bit of opening stuff. It's weird when you're sitting with your back to the, well, you can't see all the audience. There's some of them behind you. A big screen on your laptop. And at one point, I closed the screen down because I was aware the light might distract or trouble them. And I closed it too far, and it went into some sort of sleep or whatever mode. And that was a glitch, which I repeated about 10 minutes later. So being adept at your computer is essential. The next slide will show something that all Simon Hanmer friends or viewers of some of his work with Seeker, a program that he and I share our like and dislike for. But this, I didn't expect this to turn out. I wasn't in charge of any of the photography. The man doing it thought he'd try a screenshot. And of course, these objects are in motion. He didn't have a tripod, et cetera, et cetera. So the blur is inevitable. All right, we'll see the finale here. People coming up to me to mostly, I guess, to say they enjoyed it. Well, I couldn't take in how much they enjoyed it as I was doing it. The mechanics of the presentation, although I had much of it mechanized and strung together, was still took a lot of concentration. And the glitches when I closed the lid. But I did hear very good news later from many people. The next is, here Mike can take a bow because he provided the Sky News magazine, which I was able to distribute, and people enjoyed getting it, and I've heard some nice comments about its content. And the next one, the next two show various other people. It's like a receiving or an exit line. I'm not quite sure. So that's all I have to say. If Attila lives up to what he's told me already, I'll be able to show you maybe 15 or 20 minutes of the main stuff in August.
Thank you very much, Tom.
Hey, thank you. All right. You can probably go to the first slide there. So extrasolar planets have been in the news quite a bit lately. And in fact, it's hard to believe that only roughly 20 years ago, we didn't have any confirmation of any planet outside of our own solar system. And with the Kepler mission just launched a month ago, we're expecting to see, or hoping to see, a lot more planets discovered over the coming years. So I thought this would be a good opportunity to take a tally of of what planets have been detected so far and what we know about them. Well, overall, we've detected about 348, I should say confirmed 348 planets, and existing in 295 planetary systems. And there are actually several different websites you can go to that give you all the details of which stars those planets are about and the various properties. Go to the next slide. So there are about five different methods that are currently used to detect extrasolar planets, which I'm going to go through. We'll go start with the first one, which is known as gravitational wobble. And the basics are that if you have a large enough planet orbiting a star, both the star and the planet exert a gravitational pull on one another. And so what's happening is that the planet is not so much orbiting the star, but the two are orbiting their common center of gravity. And so if the planet is big enough or massive enough compared with its star, the star itself will seem to wobble. It will do an orbit of its own. And we can detect that through the light, through the shifting of the spectrum, shifting of the starlight in the spectrum. And this is basically known as the Doppler effect. So the star is moving towards us, the light becomes bluer. The star is moving away from us, becomes redder. And so we can estimate from the star's velocity what the mass of that planet is. And when we observe it over an entire orbit, we can deduce how far that planet is away from that star. And this is the method that's responsible for the vast majority of the planets outside of our solar system that have been confirmed. Now, the one consequence of this method is, as you can probably imagine, is that the easiest planets to detect through this method are the ones that are very massive compared to their star, but also the ones that are very close to their star, because the star itself will have a greater velocity, and you can detect that in the spectrum much more easily. So next question. Microlensing is one technique. If you happen to have a star that is almost in line of sight with another star beyond it, the gravity of the star that's closer to us will bend the light of the further star. And if there happens to be a planet in orbit about the closer star, that extra bit of gravity will cause a bit of a distortion. So you can see, compare the top plot, which is if the star is by itself, and the bottom plot. So the planet's own gravity is also adding a little bit to that lens effect. But as you can imagine, this only is helpful if we happen to have two stars that are very closely lined up with one another, and only eight planets have been found by this method so far. Oh, next one. So direct imaging. These are images that have come to us fairly recently. The one at the top right was actually spearheaded by a group based at University of Toronto, and that came out, I believe, late last year. This is one of those few images where the planet has enough light reflected off of its surface that we can image it visually. The image on the bottom right is from the Hubble, and that's of a star well known to amateur astronomers as Fomalhaut, or Alpha Pisces Austrianus. It's got a large disk of some sort of debris, but as you can see in the inset there is a planet that the Hubble actually observed move. So from one point to the other, I think that's a 1 year stretch. So it's only recently that we've started to get these images of actual visual images of planets around other stars, and only 11 so far. Timing. So there are, I guess, two big categories here. Interestingly enough, the very first planet that was detected or confirmed outside of our solar system was not about a kind of star that we would have expected a planet to be around. It was around a neutron star, a pulsar. And the reason that it was detected is that pulsars radiate the signal at a very, very precise frequency. And so if you see a slight alteration in that frequency, that tells you that there's some other object exerting a gravitational pull on the pulsar. And this kind of caught astronomers by surprise, because pulsars, neutron stars, are products of supernova explosions. And no one thought that a planetary system would survive such a thing. So it may well be a planetary system that formed after the supernova, but no one knows for sure. The other category involves what are known as eclipsing binaries. So if you have two stars that are orbiting about one another, and one happens to pass in front of the other, you will see a regular brightening and dimming of the light. And again, if there's a slight deviation from this regular pattern, you know that there's some other object around there that's causing a gravitational influence. And if you find it's in the right mass range, you say that's a planet. But again, only about seven planets in total have been found through these two methods. So finally we get to what's known as the transit method. And this is the method that the Kepler mission will be using. And it's very simple. The planet, if a planet actually passes directly in front of the star as we see it from the Earth, and we see this over repeat orbits, that counts as a detection. And in fact, one of the nice things about this method is that not only do you get the period of the planet, but you also, from the amount that the light of the star dips, you can get an estimate of how physically big the planet is, which is not something you can get from any of the other methods. And so you get an idea of how dense the planet is and get an idea sense for what materials it's made of. Now, as you can imagine, this method only works if the planet happens to be orbiting in a plane that's edge-on as we see from the Earth. The vast majority of cases, if we assume that orbits are randomly distributed, the vast majority of cases we will never see this. So in fact, geometrically, if we're talking about stars roughly in the size range of our sun, planets in the rough size range of our Earth, less than 1% of the time we would expect to see that plane go right in front of the star, the planet pass right in front of the star. And if it's an Earth-sized planet and a sun-sized star, the change in brightness is extremely small. We're talking one part in 10,000. So there are very few instruments. In fact, there are no ground-based instruments that can detect this. They can detect larger planets and larger drops of light, but there's nothing on Earth that can detect this, detect a change in brightness to that level of sensitivity. And again, we need to observe this over at least three cycles. The reason being that if we observe a drop in light at one particular point in time and another drop in light later, we don't know that those are correlated events. It's only when we see the third one and see that it's a regular period that we can say, yes, it's a planet and we've confirmed it. So, next slide. So where do these planets sit in terms of their properties? So what I've got here is plotted on the bottom scale is the mass of the planets, and this is relative to the mass of the Earth. And on the other axis, I've got what's called the semi-major axis, or the average distance that the planet orbits its star. And it's important to note this is what's known as a logarithmic plot, and which means that every grid space you see there goes up by a factor of 10. So you can see kind of two big clusters, one sort of in the 100 to 1,000 Earth masses range, so sort of Jupiter-sized and even bigger, that are about the same distance from their star that the Earth is from the Sun. And you see another cluster kind of in a similar mass range, but much, much closer to their star. And these are the planets known as hot Jupiters. These are planets that are very massive but are orbiting very close to their star. And this is another thing that has caught astronomers by surprise, because in our own solar system, all the large planets are orbiting much further. The ones that are closer to the Sun are much smaller. Not only that, but the only big planets we have in our solar system are gas giants. They're predominantly hydrogen and some helium. And we don't really see any way that a planet like that could survive in an orbit as close to its sun that as these on the bottom here. So what's interesting is if we then superimpose, we go to the next slide, planets in our own solar system on the same graph, we see that apart from Jupiter, our solar system is full of misfits. In fact, in particular, if you look on the left-hand side, you see the four what we call terrestrial planets. These are the types of planets that we would expect life as we know it to exist on. And so these are the ones that we're most interested in knowing whether they have, whether they exist. But you can see there's almost nothing in that region. And what astronomers are trying to determine is how much of what we're seeing is a reflection of the true statistics of planets outside our solar system, and how much is the effect or of the biases of the methods that we're currently using. If you recall, the vast majority of the planets plotted here are detected using the Doppler method. And that Doppler method favors planets that are much bigger than the Earth and that are much closer to its parent star. So we tend to find hot Jupiters more often with that method than we would otherwise. So it may be that our information right now is biased. So go to the next slide. This is where the Kepler mission comes in. So Kepler was launched March 6th. Sorry, that was actually not last month, but 3 months ago now. And it's almost a 1 meter diameter telescope, extremely large field of view. And its purpose is to stare at a large area of the sky at over 100,000 stars for at least 3.5 years. And again, if you recall, with the transit method, we expect fewer than 1% of the time we'll have the orbit plane of the planet nicely lined up so that a transit will happen. So if you observe a very large number of stars, that less than 1% still amounts to a very large number of planets, potentially. And again, the reason it needs to be monitoring this area for at least 3.5 years is if we're looking for Earth-sized planets and Earth-sized orbits, we need to see at least 3 orbits to confirm that it really is a planet and not just uncorrelated events. So next slide. So of course, Mr. Kepler, a lot of us know, was the one who told us that planets orbit in ellipses and not circles and helped to support this heliocentric view of our solar system. This gentleman is our man of the year, Mr. Galileo, a contemporary of Kepler's. And of course, Mr. Galileo has already had a few spacecraft named after him. First of all, a spacecraft to Jupiter. The European Union is putting together a GPS constellation named after him. And he was also had his name given to a shuttlecraft on the USS Enterprise. So NASA figure is about time that Mr. Kepler had a mission named after him. So, if we go to the next slide. There we go. So where's Kepler looking? Well, there are two main factors that were considered in selecting the region of sky. First of all, Kepler is in an orbit that's just outside of the Earth. It's orbiting the sun as it's like basically a planet unto itself. So it orbits just outside the Earth in the same plane. It needs to have a continuous view of the sky. So it can't really look anywhere in the ecliptic because once a year, the sun is going to cross in front of its field of view. Now the other thing too is that, again, we're trying to observe a very large number of stars. And where you get the largest density of stars is in the Milky Way, our galactic plane. So where it's looking is in a region just actually north of the summer triangle. So if you can picture, you've got Deneb on the sort of to the lower left there and Vega to the right. The interesting thing is that it's not looking directly at the Milky Way. And the reason being is that if you look directly at the Milky Way, right at the galactic plane, you get the largest density of stars, but a large percentage of those stars are the very distant but very luminous red giants, blue giants, and supergiants, which is all very interesting, but what Kepler is looking for are Earth-sized planets around sun-like stars. So by canting the field of view just a little bit off the galactic plane, you get smaller overall density of stars, but you get the best density of sun-like stars. So that's how they chose that. And so this is the first one of the first images that came from Kepler. And what it's actually showing in the inset on the left is a sample star that has already been confirmed from ground observations to have a planet. And it's also showing on the right there an NGC cluster where there's no planets that I'm aware of that have been detected there, but it's a large cluster of stars that may have planets themselves. And next slide. So
one question,
okay. Yes, Glenn?
More of a comment. I think that the off-plane search location was chosen to avoid interstellar extinction because the dark molecular clouds more thickly populate near the midplane, mm-hmm. and you don't see as far into the distance. So I think that's mainly it, rather than the mix of stellar types, because you're still going to have a high number of sunlight stars mm-hmm. with a slightly higher increase in the brilliant giants, supergiants, and other young stars. So I think that's the main reason for this distinction, getting away from all that dark dust.
Okay, I had read it to be the sun-like star aspect. It may have been a combination of the two.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Okay.
Thank you.
Big science. Please welcome Neil Rawlings.
Well, good evening. Al and I collaborated a bit on this presentation, just looking through the last month's news and picking out some highlights, so I'll give you a little whirlwind tour of what we thought was interesting in the last month. Okay, so I don't think any review of the last month would be complete if we didn't mention the Hubble Servicing Mission 4, which obviously made good use of the Canadarm, and a significant achievement, I think, because in many cases what they were doing up there was actually repairing instruments that were not meant to be fixed in space. So there was a whole development of brand new tool sets just for that purpose. So it was quite an ambitious mission, and by all accounts successful. I think they're just testing out the instruments now. For example, I thought this was interesting too. They removed the COSTAR, which was the optics that were put into the telescope to correct the aberration of the telescope that it was launched with. It's no longer needed because every instrument on board now has the correction built in it. And I think this is the WIFPIC 3 instrument, Wide Field Planetary Camera 3, and of course got the correction built in. It replaced the last instrument that needed that correction. So in place of COSTAR, they put in the Cosmic Origin Spectrograph. Here is the aperture it went in. This is the axial instrument, and other instruments go in as a radial. So they have two different form factors. So we can look forward to some great new images. The other instruments that were repaired were the Advanced Camera for Surveys and the Space Telescope Imaging Spectrograph, which hadn't been working for a while. ACS was a relatively new instrument that they needed to fix up readout electronics. It's kind of interesting, they actually are using a small ASIC, application-specific integrated circuit, that is going to be used on JWST, so we get an early test of some JWST hardware. So kind of working our way outwards into space, I think you're all familiar with the Cassini mission, which is generating great results, but there's another mission out there orbiting a planet right now, or attempting to. It's slowly getting into a more fixed orbit. Right now it's in a long looping orbit, so every once in a while you hear news from the MESSENGER spacecraft that's trying to circularize its orbit around Mercury. And the interesting results there last month, I guess, were discovery of the youngest large impact crater, Rembrandt Basin. It's quite young for Mercury. And also more information on the magnetic field. Mercury has a pretty good magnetic field, rather similar in structure to Earth's, unlike, say, Mars and Venus, which really don't have much of a magnetic field. But it is 100 times weaker, and it turns out as you can maybe imagine with that, there's a lot of interesting interaction with solar particles that leak into the magnetosphere. So there's a fair bit going on there, and I look forward to more results as the mission proceeds, I think. As we're going out into the galaxy, this is an image here in X-ray, so Chandra X-ray Observatory, and this is diffuse X-ray emission observed with the Rossi X-ray satellite. And I guess Mikhail Renivchev, if I say it right, from Munich Technical University, had this idea of, trying to figure out what this diffuse emission from the galaxy is in X-rays. So he observed this field here with Chandra. This is a good example of an older instrument giving you a synoptic view, and then a more powerful instrument with better resolution zooming in. And so here, I don't know if you can see it, but this is the view that Chandra got, and this diffuse glow breaks up into many small chunks. And the idea here is that this hot diffuse gas is actually around dead white dwarfs and expired stars. And that's just what we have to look out for when we're mapping the diffuse X-ray glow of galaxies. So like I said, it's a good example of higher resolution telling you what the emission's actually from. Another example is some work continued from Hubble Advanced Camera and from surveys. These are dwarf galaxies, and this is a project led by Kirsten McQuinn of the University of Minnesota. And basically what she found and her team found was that dwarf galaxies, which are fairly new to astronomers, there have been I remember in the 90s being quite taken aback by the number of these dwarf galaxies that people were seeing, and they're learning more and more about them as the years go by, and we find out that the star formation in these galaxies is actually a lot more extensive and happens for a lot longer time. So that's the what's coming out now. And I think there'll be more and more results coming from dwarf galaxy studies in the next few years. For one thing, like our Milky Way is actually, well, the local cluster that Milky Way is in is actually fairly devoid of dwarf galaxies for some reason, and that's a mystery they're working on. So the next two news items are actually on black holes. This is relatively older news, but I couldn't resist throwing it in. I'm more of an observer. I just never was comfortable with black holes. By definition, you can't really observe them directly, but of course you can observe their effects. So this is a wonderful work that's been done over the years by the UCLA group. And what they've done is infrared, very high resolution infrared imaging of the galactic core, seeing all these very bright stars that are actually in orbit around the galactic core. So here you can watch their orbits. And I think what is really neat here is watch the, it'll play again, I think. Watch the green orbit, this one here. Isn't that quite amazing? And the yellow orbit. That is what a 6 million solar mass object, you know, within the space of a well, singularity, but I guess an event horizon of a few kilometers can actually do. So I thought that was pretty dramatic. So I'm starting to believe they actually exist. But so getting to the point of the more recent news, again from the X-ray world, there are actually two very productive X-ray observatories out there right now. Is the ESA's XMM Newton Observatory and Chandra, which I already mentioned with the glow in our galaxy. And in this case, this was a distant active galaxy. This is an artist's rendition. But what's interesting is that by looking at the high energy X-rays and the way they escape from the accretion disk, remember I said black holes can only be seen by their effects. Well, when they're sucking in matter, you can start to see them in a lot of high energy. And iron is emits spectral lines, and those spectral lines Doppler shift as the gas goes around. It reflects off the gas that's in falling, and even that, it even has to climb out of the gravitational well of the black hole. So there's a lot going on. That light gets shifted around spectrally, and this team has deconvolved all that and basically got to what they observing gas they believe is in a couple kilometers of this of the event horizon, which is quite impressive. And then on the other side here, we see a black hole that's basically turned off now, but it's got the diffuse X-ray glow from when it was a more active system. And this is a combination X-ray and radio and optical image. Okay, so that's it for black holes. The other good news, or big news last month, was the discovery of the most distant objects in the universe. There are actually two here. This is a chart of all the objects known, and of course, astronomers measure distance or look back time in terms of redshift. So here we are, zero, this would be present day, and so this is also showing the age of the universe, how far, you know, light, how long light took to get from that object to here. And there's the new one. It's a gamma ray burst that occurred in April, and they actually caught its afterglow in a number of telescopes around the world. And that afterglow, by imaging in optical infrared, they were able to tell at what epoch, what age of the universe this object actually went off at. And the interesting thing is that it proves that there are, well, gamma ray bursts are still a bit mysterious, but they're pretty sure that they come from, say, coalescing neutron star pairs, a real big disturbance that puts a lot of energy out there. But it means that fairly massive objects were around very early in the universe. We're talking only 0.7 or 700 million years after the Big Bang. So that's quite impressive. The other object is Himiko, and it was discovered by Masami Ohichi of Carnegie Institution, and it is basically a blob of hydrogen in space. Normally, lots of these are seen, but they're seen in absorption. Here, this is actually seen as an emitting object, and it was discovered as a point six, not quite as distant, but still pretty far. So this is interesting too. This means there's a lot of matter collecting together fairly early in the universe. So it's interesting news. We always hear about the furthest, most distant object, and here are two fairly unique ones. But maybe there'll be more coming up soon. This is a good lead-in, actually, to Bob's talk tomorrow. I encourage you all to attend. He's an excellent speaker, very dynamic, and he'll tell you all about cosmic dawn, which is shown in this diagram here. You know, the cosmic microwave background. We look back to just when the last scattering of photons from matter occurred. And then the universe went dark for a time, and this is blown up on this picture here. And then slowly, the first stars and star clusters form, and they start to reionize the universe, and it'll look more like, well, it does today out here, redshift 0. So by going to redshift 8, as that object we just heard about, puts you back in here, so reionization is happening. We know from studies of the cosmic microwave background, reionization really happened in this region, and like I said, it's interesting to find out the massive stars and massive blobs of hydrogen gas exist fairly early in the universe, and I'm sure Bob will tell you a lot more about this tomorrow. So that's it for my summary.
We have a couple things to give out. These are brochures from Starfest. Starfest, in the Ellenclaw event, you don't know, is the largest star party in Canada. Approximately 600 geeks got together for anywhere from a weekend to a week and share observing telescopes. If you want to shop for a telescope, every kind of telescope will be there. It is a lot of fun. We have a bunch of magazine back issues to give away. Feel free to take as many as you like. We have a couple of free samples of astronauts in the event that you're not a club member. Immediately after this meeting, we're going to go out into the lobby and share some caffeine and cookies with Anne and Art Fraser. And this is the right time to harangue the speakers about whether or not you believe it was stellar distribution or dark clouds, or would like to ask questions, or otherwise engage them. Immediately afterwards, some of us who prefer to do exactly the same thing over alcohol and chicken wings go to Kelsey's across the street. June 20th, we've had a request, very late-breaking request, from the Italian Canadian Youth Formation for a bunch of astronauts to show up to their event to talk about astronomy. And they're happy to just see telescopes on display and have people to answer astronomical questions. But we're kind of hoping you might be able to do some public solar observing. So if you'd like to volunteer for this, please show up. Apparently, they may feed us afterwards. So this is the first time we've actually gotten a real inducement to do public astronomy. Just an announcement about Fred Lossing Observatory. We've created a Yahoo group, which is a mailing list for friends of Fred Lossing Observatory. This is a mailing list for people who wish to help out with the observatory. That's the URL. If you can't remember that, just remember friends of Fred Lossing Observatory. That's what FO_FLO stands for. For those of you who haven't been out there, we have a 16-inch telescope. So all of you are thinking, oh, these are very big challenges. They're too hard. I need a incredible telescope, at least 16 inches. Well, there's one right here, and any of the members can use it. Pat Brown. Pat, are you here? Pat is going to be giving a training course on how to use a telescope, I believe, this Sunday.
Yes.
So if you're a member and you'd like to learn how to use a scope, talk to Pat.
The scope is really doing a good job, and the observing challenge would be something to try on that scope. I did other observing challenges in the last 2 weeks, and it's an excellent scope.
Yeah, this scope has a long history. It's discovered over how many comets?
Five.
Awesome. Next month we'll have a swap table just before the meeting. Bring all the stuff you want to sell and come with pockets full of cash.
Including
hot
telescopes.
Including hot or cool telescopes rather. Next meeting will be 8 p.m. July 3rd with the swap meet just before. And finally, I'd like to thank all the very large people who did a lot of work putting this. Some of these presentations are very sophisticated. I'd particularly like to thank Richard McDonald, the guy in the dark corner here. If you're wondering how the incredible and the slide changes works, or how when you just say next and it's like it's Richard doing all that magic in the background, I'd particularly like to thank Chris Tern, who said he couldn't be here tonight. It was really sad that he couldn't come here tonight, but he said he would like to see the DVD of this. Chris Tarrant is recovering from spinal cord surgery in his neck, and he was told no email, no telephone calls for 4 weeks. Now, he had a surgery a week ago, and he did almost all of the integration of the slide pack. He spent, I think, 2 man-days working on the editing integration, and he fixed, like, there are all kinds of integration problems. We had videos that would not play in various players. We had pictures that were too large and needed resizing. We had fonts that wouldn't transfer. He figured all this stuff from his bed wearing prism glasses.
He'll get the first copy.
So I'd like to give my applause for everyone who made this meeting possible, particularly to Chris, who is basically crazy.